and welcome to Sports Extra, your very own program. Along this week, we've been discussing many other sports alongside cricket, but today is a purely cricket show today because we have a lot to talk about. And the main story that's surfacing all around is that Virat Kohli was caught doing ball tampering, not this match, but last match. Because it was last match, so he can go scot-free. And he can do whatever, and maybe 6 months later he can do it again and not get caught, or have the favors of the gentlemen who can catch him, and then this could keep going. What we have to establish today here is that, is ball tampering an actual issue? Is it a crime? If it's if you're going beyond the rules and doing ball tampering, going against the rule, then what sort of punishment should be given to you, and whether you should be banned for a few matches or not. The other topics, of course, are the Hamilton Test match, and of course England also starting the new Test match in a few days. So these are the hot topics that we got to discuss today. We have got two very able gentlemen in the studios today. We'll go directly to one of our very regular guests. Assalamu alaikum, Zaidi Saab, how are you?
Walaikum assalam. I'm great. How are you?
I'm well, thank you very much. And a very young, dashing Behram, who's been very, very interested in cricket all his life, writes blogs and articles on cricket also, is a genuine cricket, young cricket analyst. Assalamu alaikum, Behram, how are you doing?
Walaikum assalam, Leena. Always a pleasure to be on the show.
My pleasure also. Zaidi Saab, we will start with you. You saw the pictures of Virat Kohli doing what he did, was doing in the Raj Court test, and I saw him doing similar things in this test match also, and I thought to myself, this is a different style of shining the ball. Normally someone would just lick the saliva and then rub on the ball. This was like he was brushing his teeth or something. And then also we will compare it to Fluff Duplessis's ball tempering also. He was also only fined 100% of his fee. I feel both these punishments are not enough. If it's a crime, then both these gentlemen should have gotten at least 2 to 3 test match bans.
When I saw the film in which Kohli was in fact putting his right hand deep into his throat and trying to bring out that taste of mint over the ball. Well, this story has been leaked by Daily Mail in England, and in fact, this violates the code of ethics.
As we can see on our screens once again, what Kohli is doing.
Yes, same thing which Faf du Plessis did. I think both were doing the same thing. Well, 2.2.9, it is the code of ethics which in fact regulates this type of behavior. And in fact, level 2 punishment was required for Kohli. But I think ICC people unofficially said it's a 9 days old story. We don't need to go into it. On the other hand, when Faf du Plessis does it at Hobart, well, he's caught and he has been punished with 100% match fee punishment.
Absolutely.
That is level 2 punishment. He could get the a ban for the third for Adelaide Test too.
Absolutely, he should have gotten it. And Kohli, whether it was 9 days ago or whether it was 100 days ago, once it's the story is leaked by a newspaper or source and it's very clear on cameras, I think then ICC, if they want to if they want to make an example out of this, and they don't want other people to indulge in ball tampering, then this was a classic chance they had, a fine chance that they had to punish Kohli, who's the captain of the leading test team in the world, and actually is known to be a pretty a fair man, and also 100% match fee is not a great punishment. I think 100% match fee is just pocket change for these guys.
Well, coming sooner to the issue of ball tampering. So the ICC's Code of Conduct Law 42.3 states that a ball can be polished to be shined as long as no artificial substance is used to aid the shining.
Absolutely.
So now Cricket South Africa is questioning whether what constitutes of this artificial substance. And as far as Kohli and even David Warner was applying lip balm to shine the ball in this Hobart Test Day 3. The rule in the ICC states that if an incident is not reported to the match referee within 5 days of that incident, it is completely overlooked, which is not, it doesn't seem very fair to Faf du Plessis because he was caught doing the exact same thing that Kohli and Warner were. But since the deadline has passed, he was made the scapegoat while Kohli and Warner got no punishment. But
so,
then again,
so it means that action has been legalized.
But what I feel, what I personally feel is that this is a grey area in the ICC's code of conduct. They should look at this example and actually identify the different types of artificial substances that can be and cannot be used to shine
the ball.
Good
point, good point. Because, you know,
I'll add to what he's saying. He's saying very correct things. But I would ask, where was the third umpire? I mean, when the game was going on, third umpire had got the monitor in front of him and he was watching each and every delivery. Though the umpires on the field, they don't see it. Well, why didn't he object? ICC is now saying that in both the cases, third umpire or the referee, they didn't refer it to the to ICC.
Well, coming back to that point, Faf du Plessis in his press conference, he added and he pointed this out, that this practice of using candy or gum to shine the ball is regularly used by players and is accepted by players. So why don't the on-field umpires call this out, and why does the media have to spot it for it to come in the spotlight? So like I said
I would like to go into history, what he is. In fact, he is inviting us to go into history.
Sure.
Well, in 1977, England team was visiting India, and there was a bowler named John Lever. He, in fact, got seven wickets against the Indians. And at that time, nobody knew about this ball tampering issue.
Absolutely.
But later on, it appeared in the press that he was, in fact, using Vaseline on his
forehead. Yes,
from
his
here he was using it on the ball, and he got seven wickets.
Okay.
Then coming back to when Pakistan's Wasim and Waqar in mid-90s, they were criticized vigorously by the Australian media, English media, and other media, Indian media too. But nothing could be proved.
Absolutely. Now, we've established that there are many ways of tempering with a ball. You pick the ball with your nail, you can shine it with the Vaseline, you can do it with a toffee, you can do it with a bottle top, you can do it with a zipper on the side of your trousers, you can do it with so many things. And now, it is also, let's be fair to the ICC also, it is not going to be easy to catch these, you know, all these players, because it is something, it is a practice that's been going on from years and years. So it is not going to be an easy thing to stop this. But one of the things that they can do is that when they catch someone, they should straight away put a couple of matches ban. Because 100% match fee, these players earn in millions. You know, 100% is not going to be, they're not going to be too bothered. And the other thing that I want to discuss now is the absurd rule that, you know, you can, if the same offense is repeated within the same 12 months, same calendar year, twice, then you can be, you know, punished more severely. But if you do it with a, do an offense today and then you do it after 13 months, you're not going to be punished so severely. What kind of absurd rule is this, sir?
Yes, it is. Well, I'll add one more thing. There was a New Zealand bowler named Chris Pringle. He got 11 wickets against Pakistan at Faisalabad, I think in 1990. He has written autobiography in which he has said that I was involved in ball tampering. What about these players who are confessing that they did it and got 11 wickets? Why don't you throw them out of the cricket books?
Records. Records shouldn't stand, you say.
Yes. What I see, feel is that they should be thrown out of the
cricket. But, sir, this is a very severe punishment, Zaidi Saab, that you are asking for. First, the, you know, the current players who are caught on camera, first let's punish them, Behram.
And you are talking about the zipper. I think it was, the play was Faf du Plessis.
Against us, 2013, against Pakistan.
He is facing the ICC panel for the second time. I mean, they must have
but
been
But since there be two years gap, so he can get away with that.
He should have got a ban, I think, for the Adelaide Test match.
Absolutely. Behram, your take.
Well, like I said earlier, this is a very grey area and the ICC has misused it and possibly not aptly punished players who have been involved in the past. But what I'd like to point out here is that this particular incident has brought shining the ball with an artificial substance, this particular issue into the spotlight. And many former players, such as Matt Prior, wicketkeeper of England, even tweeted saying that this is a common practice amongst players everywhere.
Oh, absolutely
so
it is. Even in Pakistan, in first class games, it's just common, very common.
What I want from the ICC is black and white. Mm. Either you punish them and state the rules, what is allowed, what is not allowed, or you don't do anything at all.
Or they should be allowed.
What I don't agree with is making Faf du Plessis the scapegoat. Mm. And I do, I think that's probably why he did not get a match ban, because it was a level 2 offense, I believe. But that's probably why he got a lesser suspension of 100% match fee.
But like you said, you know, like Behram Singh, Zazi Saab, it's a grey area. And when often in every, in all the matches we see, one day matches, test matches, we see that the player would be shining his the ball on his trousers and then he will lick his fingers and go like this. So all that time, who's to know whether he's got this chewing gum in his mouth? Who's to know that these 50, 100 years, who had the chewing gum and who didn't? You know?
In England, they're calling it lolligate or mentigate. what is the ICC Committee for Rules and Regulations doing there? They are being paid heftily. What are they doing? I mean, if they can't make the rules, I mean, as our friend was saying, that they needed amendment, what are they doing?
And that's exactly
and
what...
And then, Behram, shouldn't they also, I'll let you complete what you're saying, but shouldn't they also have a brand of chewing gum that should be allowed? I mean, that's the only way they can control it.
That's exactly the point I was going to make. Yeah. And this is the point that Faf du Plessis brought up in his press conference, is that if this is something that is such a big a deal and this it is black and white, then everyone should deserve the same treatment as him. And this is something that should be spotted by the on-field umpires rather than the television camera. So if there is an illegal substance that is being used to polish the ball, the on-field umpires are supposed to call them out and they should report it to the match referee. And everyone should get equal treatment.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, you heard so much from our experts. And what I'm also saying is that whether Kohli did it 9 days ago, whether Warner did it at the Hobart test, both of these gentlemen should be punished alongside, of course, du Plessis, who shouldn't have gotten away with just a slap on the wrist, you know, was saying, okay, you can, here, I'll come and hit you here and now you can go and play. Like, you know, when we say to our children, they do something naughty, we call them, we just give them a light slap on the wrist or slap on the face and say, okay, now you can play. So it's like, you know, you're allowing them to play after they've committed a crime.
Lina, when du Plessis' hearing was going on that morning, this story about Virat Kohli appeared in the press. I mean, ICC could easily have got two inquiries in one go.
Oh, absolutely. And whether it was done 6 days ago or 9 days ago shouldn't make
it doesn't
a difference.
Matter.
Once it surfaces, once you're caught cheating or lying, in normal life, you don't get away. You know, if you lied, and even if someone catches you, say about 2 months later, that person's going to come to you and say, "Man, you lied that time. Why did you do that?" And if you will be inevitably punished for that, whether it's a friend you lied with to a friend, he's going to stop talking to you or something. You are going to get your due punishment. Then why not in cricket?
If you want to clean cricket from these practices, you must need to amend the rules.
Well, adding to that, I'm in full agreement with that concept that the rules should be black and white and clear punishments should be very clear and everything in the code of conduct must not have any grey area. That said, Faf du Plessis has received enormous support from even the Australian players and ex-players because this is a common practice at the end of the day. So they do sympathize with him being the scapegoat in this situation.
Absolutely. This is a test for the ICC because they're often accused of being, you know, in favor of the of the Indians. They're often accused of being subservient to the Indians, not, you know, being biased when it comes to the Indians. This is a test of their character. If they can... give any sort of punishment to Virat Kohli, warn him, or just, you know, tell him that he's not supposed to do it again. If he does it again, he'll be banned for 2 matches. This be a test for them. And there is a lot of pressure being built on the ICC. And that is where I feel they need to respond quickly. And they need to do it before. We have to move to the next topic. So quickly say what you want.
Yeah. More importantly, I would just like to add that the ICC has to decide how to take the game forward. Because now this is an issue. It's in the spotlight. And we've seen videos of David Warner and Virat Kohli's surface. So now is the time to take a stand and make that rule black or white and take a decision which would show the way forward.
And Zazi Saab, your last word on this before we move
Well,
on.
My last word is that when Pakistanis were being involved into this malpractice, I'll call it, every Australian English pressman was writing on that. But when their bowlers like Anderson and Stuart Broad and others, they started doing it, they were in fact using an art.
Yes, we've heard this before also, and Jeffrey Bycott to that effect was really great. He said that the Pakistani bowlers, even if you gave them orange and asked them to bowl on a glass pitch, they'll be able to swing the ball. So, you know, these things didn't really matter because the Pakistani bowlers were so skillful. Now, I think the Anderson and, you know, Flintoff and these bowlers are very skillful also. And so, you know, skill is another thing and tempering is another thing. We got to establish the difference between two. And when we sort of suspect tempering or we spot it, it should be punished. And now moving on to another very important topic, which of course interests every Pakistani, is that Pakistan, after losing the first test match, is going to play the second test match at Hamilton from the 25th of November. Very important test match, Pakistan minus Misbah. This is going to be a test of character for Pakistan, also test of character for the team, test of character for Azhar Ali, how he's going to respond when they're such a you know, accomplished captain of 50 test matches and close to 30 test match wins, he's not present. Let's see how Azhar Ali and his team are going to respond, what changes they're going to make. Zaidi Saab, I'm going to start with you. Is Sharjeel Khan going to play or not?
To be honest, I'm not in favor of that.
Okay.
Because he's more like a one-day batsman. And he's fond of playing in the air. I mean, airy strokes. And he offers his wicket too early in the innings. Well, Pakistan requires the traditional openers. I mean, Sami Aslam and Azhar Ali might be the two. I'm still not satisfied with them too. Because Azhar Ali, though he got a triple century, but still he had got many ducks too.
Absolutely. But there is a, we have a slight problem because Misbah is not available. So do you think then, if not Sharjeel, do you think then Rizwan should replace him?
Well, Rizwan, you know, we have been projecting him when he was making his entry into Pakistan team when World Cup side was being finalized. Well, I think he's a good batsman, but still, I think it will be demanding too much from him to be one of the sides. We are expecting a lot from it. Okay. Because we want to see Pakistan winning the next test match.
Absolutely. I would take the risk with Sharjeel only because, you know, he's an aggressive batsman at the top. Like Zaidi Saab said, he's not a test player. But how do you become a test player? Once you're given the opportunity, if you do well in trying conditions, and he's got the strokes to do well in New Zealand, Australia, because he can cut well, he can pull well. So if he does well at the top and gives the innings that fillip, that impetus that a Pakistani innings clearly needs after their defensive display, do you think it might be a good idea to give him a chance?
Well, before stating my opinion, I'd like to highlight what Mickey Arthur had to say about replacing Misbah. And he's slightly tilted towards playing Rizwan because he does play in the number 5 slot.
And he mentioned that he scored, got two good hundreds.
167 and 95 in the Qaid-e Azam Trophy. So yes, he is leaning towards playing Rizwan also because they won't have to shuffle the batting order in that case. But then again, he himself said that Sharjeel Khan reminds him of a young David Warner and he has that power to take the game away from the opposition with his aggressive nature. So I personally would like to see Sharjeel debut.
It'll be very exciting if nothing else.
Yes.
I mean, if he gets 4 or 5 boundaries, he might just shift the pressure towards the New Zealanders. For instance, if he gives a start of 40 runs and he has 3 or 4 boundaries in that,
But Leena, my question is, can we afford this risk on a wicket which we must be having a tinge of grass on it?
But can we, the other option we have is Rizwan. And also, he hasn't done really well at test level, international level, as he was expected to, Zaidi Saab, because we saw that, first of all, he had that weakness playing the leg spinner. His bat was going, you know, towards the cover. So he was getting, there was a bat and pad gap created and he was getting bowled. So that problem he might not have here because it's not a spinner's wicket and they might not have.
And most of these youngsters, they have got flowing bats because of ODI cricket, too much ODI
cricket.
Because
the bat goes like this,
and,
you know.
They are not traditional, conventional test match cricketers. So I think, yes, you are right, bringing in Rizwan also creates a danger for the team.
So then we might as well bring someone who's exciting and give it a try.
Well,
if you can bring him as an opener, I mean, I'm talking about Sharjeel, and bring in Rizwan at middle order. What about this?
Then that will be two changes. We can't drop. We only have one place to for.
You need to have more than one change.
Who else would you like to change?
Well, I want to see Wahab Riaz in the side.
Yes, but well, yes, yeah, definitely.
In the at the start of the on the first day of the test match, I was of the opinion that Pakistan should play with four fast bowlers as New Zealand did. Mm-hmm. Well, the wicket was green, and some of the cricket critics were writing that both sides had got fast bowlers who wicket was mouth watering.
And Behram, your take on this?
Yes, indeed, I would too play Wahab Riaz on this surface because Seddon Park has a history of reverse swing.
Yes, and Wahab, he's done here.
And Wahab has pace, and he can Wahab can have the same sort of effect in your bowling lineup that Neil Wagner has in New Zealand's bowling lineup. He can hit the deck hard, throw in those short bounce, deliveries, and also exploit reverse swing. But who would you like? The question is though, who would they rest in this game, because Rahat Ali has had a very good game and Sohail Khan is contributing with the bat.
He is creating a variation in the side, right?
Exactly.
Well, then but they could drop the leg spinner, but then they won't do that.
Well, I was of the view that Yasir Shah should not have been played in the Christchurch test because there was no spin in the wicket.
Yeah, but this test they're saying, or they might be playing mind games, Behram. Certain New Zealand players are saying that, you know, Yasir Shah is such a good bowler and, you know, he could have impact in Hamilton. Do you think that those could be mind games?
They could well definitely be mind games because I have read the pitch conditions and the forecast. And with the overcast conditions and possible rain, I think the pitch will it will benefit seamers way more than it will spin. But this Seddon Park pitch also has a history of slightly drying up. But with the rain, that could all be cancelled out. So it's a tricky one.
Okay. If we had a Pakistani coach, for sure I would have known he would never drop Yasir Shah. And with this Santner issue, Santner coming back for New Zealand, they would have said, oh yaar, wo to khila rahe, we will also play them. So, you know, with the foreign coach, we still have a chance that he might take a brave decision and say, okay, we want to rest the leg spinner because he's no use here, the conditions won't favour him, and we will go with four
pacers.
It's
such a risk. England played three spinners at Vishakhapatnam and still lost the game.
Absolutely.
They thought their spinners could win the game for them.
Well, Mickey Arthur is of the opinion that if three fast bowlers can't do the job, then four will definitely not, and he wants to play horses for courses. I think Yasir Shah is such an incredible talent that they don't want to drop him just yet.
Absolutely.
But in the last
correct.
Test match, I agree with Zaidi Saab, I wouldn't be absolutely baffled to see four seamers start that test. But coming into this one, I personally would have to drop Sohail Khan because Rahat Ali has impressed me. And even though having a three-pronged left armor attack does not, like, there's not a lot of variation, but I am of the opinion that you should definitely play your three best fast bowlers. And if there's the slightest chance of the wicket turning, then Yasir Shah should be in the 11 for the Hamilton test.
Okay. But my objection is that if you drop Sohail Khan, then you'll be playing with all left-arm fast-medium bowlers.
It will
be very easy for New Zealand batsmen
to cope with them.
Yes, there will be no variety. You must have a right-arm fast-medium.
Absolutely. I would take the risk and probably go, although I'm of the opinion and always have been of the opinion that a leg spinner is your match winner on any conditions, especially against the tail enders. He could get you wickets quickly. Yasir Shah has not now already gotten some taste of the New Zealand conditions. He will be more used to bowling here. Second test match, first test match, there was no side game. It was washed away because of rain. So, right, he could be a great option, but still, you know, in order to equalize the series, and having seen Wahab Riaz's record here at Hamilton, I would still take the risk and go with four pace bowlers. So what? I mean, you know, we take the risk sometimes.
I mean, you are saying that weather will be hazy and murky. And well, it will be very useful for Pakistani fast bowlers. One right arm and three left arm. But Yasir Shah doesn't have a place. He can be successful if there is sun and the wicket dries up.
This is a very horses for courses action that is sometimes very necessary. In life, although we learn this very late, and not when you're in our 20s or 30s, but you sometimes realize, that horses for courses is actually a great thing.
Lina, Misbah selected him for the side, but in the first innings, he bowled only four overs. And in the second innings, I think he was hit all around. So he that was not a good move as far as Yasir Shah's performance is concerned. Well, he might be very useful when playing in Melbourne or not in Brisbane, but at Sydney. I have been to all these places and I've seen the wickets. But Melbourne and Sydney are two different things. In Hamilton, I don't think you need Yasir Shah.
Okay, well, now let's talk about the batsmen a wee bit.
I want to end on this. The conditions of the weather also play a big part over here, because if it's sunny, then Yasir Shah can of course be a
Absolutely,
weapon. But if it's overcast and muggy, then it's all about the swing bowlers. And lastly, I think the toss is very important.
Because, as it was in the first test match.
The wickets in New Zealand get better to bat on as the test match progresses.
So batting second is a good idea.
Exactly. Yeah. And you have to put in the opposition to bat first. That is the way to go. So all the best to Team Pakistan.
No one has any control over the toss. It's such
Lina
a nightmare.
Had
no.
Pakistan given a total of around 200 runs
on the board
to be attained in fourth innings, it would have been a difficult task.
Absolutely, because you know.
But your batting didn't click.
Yeah, so that's why now we are going to be talking about the batting. The Pakistani batting didn't click, as we all know. And yesterday, with my guest Nasrullah, we were having a little discussion, and he pointed out that the way they could have faced Grandholm, who didn't have so much pace, was. The batsman could have stood outside the crease and, you know, countered in from there. And they could have, you know, with their technique, you can change it a wee bit. Like sometimes, you know, we see batsmen make the bat lift less or more according to the bowlers. You know, if the bowler's really fast, then of course they make it a little less because there's no time for a high back lift. So we can do something like that in order to sort of handle the pacers in New Zealand.
Since you were talking about batting, my biggest worry is that we have lost the best batsman which Pakistan had. I'm in shape of Misbah. And how are we going to fill that slot?
It will be very, very difficult for Pakistan.
Well, just considering that we have tended to take a more defensive approach of late, that's exactly why I would like to see Shajeel Khan open. But the only problem with that is that Azhar Ali has been opening for a while, and that seemed to be his designated spot now.
Although I think he's the best number three bet we have.
They really want to, Mickey Arthur and his coaching staff, want to push Babar Azam as Pakistan's future and number three batsman. So that plan would jeopardize all of this, which is why they are leaning towards Rizwan. But I personally believe that in the first innings in the last test match, Pakistan's batsmen, they lacked a bit of discipline. They fetched some deliveries that should have been left, and they could have posted a slightly better first innings total, which would have changed the entire complexion of the game.
In fact, I was expecting best of this discipline display by Asad Shafiq, whom I think is the best technically sound batsman in Pakistan's side. Unfortunately, he also behaved very immaturely.
Absolutely. Now, what about the change in the stance that we were discussing that I just pointed out? What if they stand just a little bit outside the crease to handle Grandholm, who's not very quick, but he bowls to a fuller length and can swing the ball?
Well, it depends on whether they want to play on the front foot or the back foot. So, if they are wanting to defend and sit back, then that would not make a difference.
What's the best option according to you guys?
Well, I don't think Pakistan's test team is a very attacking unit. So, they should stick to what they do best and wait for their runs. Make most of the loose deliveries.
But in the past, we've seen that, you know, sometimes it's been pointed out all the time. Sometimes you see Yunus Khan standing outside the crease, or sometimes you see him inside the crease. Also, Misbah, who's essentially a defensive batsman, sometimes stands outside just to counter the swing, or, you know, someone's bowling full, you just play it on the front foot. I mean, I'm a big fan of people using the box and using the crease, the depth of the crease. But I'm also a big fan of countering some bowlers on front foot.
Well, Lina, I'd like to point out the fact that in the past 5-6 years, every time Pakistan have counter-attacked, it's on spin bowling. We saw that how they treated Moeen Ali in the England series.
That luxury we won't have.
That is a luxury they don't have, because even Mitchell Santner, he's not a frontline bowler. I think he's more of a batsman than the bowler, because he does a real good effort with
him. What about Grandholm? He was originally a batsman.
Batsman.
We converted him into a bowler.
So we converted many people into Ganguly and Phil Simmons and God knows who else.
So the fact that New Zealand has such a strong seam attack and most of their overs are all bowled by seamers, that really hurts Pakistan, because over the past 5-6 years they've been defending seamers, blunting them out of the attack. That doesn't work here, because the pressure is always on them with the new seamer coming in.
No, so they've got to devise some way or the other, Zaidi Saab, to handle a four-pronged pace attack. A good four-pronged pace attack, they've got to, I'm sure they're devising a plan, whether it's to stand outside the crease, whether it's to use the depth more, the crease depth more, the box area more, or whatever, or whether it's to not be so defensive. When the ball, when the opportunity arises, they need to play their drives. But the fact, I mean, I was talking to Nasrullah yesterday, and I was telling him the fact that they can't play so many drives is that the ball is seeming and they've got three or four good slippers at the back. So they're scared whether if they miscue one, it'll go to the slips directly.
Yeah, then why don't you pick up singles and twos? Don't go for four runs.
Hmm.
Pick up, you look at a Kiwi batting.
Hmm.
When they were 109 for five, Pakistan could have really ripped through them. But they were, in fact, getting involved in a 20-30 runs partnership.
Small partnership.
That in fact, brought them 200 runs on the board.
And we don't really have a player which can come and counter-attack like Grandholm did in that first test. That is why Shajeel Khan's inclusion would excite me, because he's a good puller of the ball. And in this particular team, we don't have a lot of good pullers of the ball. I can think of Sarfaraz, and that's about it.
But good point you raised, because Sarfaraz being out of form also, he's one of my favorite young players.
No, I don't say out of form. They don't know how to play on these intriguing wickets, seeming wickets. They don't know how to play. They are trained on wickets which are docile.
If he gets a 50s at this up this time, then what will you say?
Well, I will just quote about the first test match. What did he do? I think he was nowhere. I mean, his footwork was bad. Well, we need to prepare good fast bowlers, wickets in Pakistan.
Absolutely.
Unless we don't do it, we cannot find good batsmen on fast wickets.
When you speak to domestic cricketers, they say that the wickets are pretty fast in Pakistan. This is our misconception.
I think the only one is at Sialkot. The other one is at Rawalpindi. How many
matches? The Diamond Ground is pretty fast.
Well, but I don't know how many of them get opportunity to play at Diamond.
There should be. I often say that the Diamond wicket is pretty fast. There should be, before going to England and Australia and New Zealand, instead of sending them here and there for 2 weeks, there should be a camp on the Diamond wicket.
Yes.
Well, in their defense, though, they haven't, like Zaidi Saab pointed out, they've been playing in the UAE, where tracks are very, very dead and keep low. So in the Pakistani batsman defense, they haven't really been exposed to such wickets. And in all fairness, this was a very, very hard wicket to bat on.
Oh, I agree. I've been defending them in every shop.
Lina, in 2004, we were in fact covering a test match between Pakistan and India. And we landed in Lahore at around sunset time. And we met Bashir, the groundman of Lahore. We asked him how the wicket is going to behave tomorrow. He said it's a top secret. Well, okay. Next day, in fact, there was a tinge of grass on the wicket. And
then it was
Umudu got 6 for 89 in that. And the match was finished over 2 days. Well, this is, you were playing against India. So if you want to make fast wickets or seeming wickets, you have got the wickets, you can convert them easily into seeming or...
I agree with you. You made your point very well. When you a flat track like Lahore was made into a seeming one, then any track could be made into a seeming one. But then the other thing that they say, that if you make too many seeming tracks, the batsmen don't score and they don't gain confidence at domestic level. When that happens, then...
And where is the confidence now?
let's just see if they respond to pressure well and that kind of thing.
Well, I do expect them to be very circumspect with their approach. They will not go out and attack like all guns blazing.
No, I
don't want them to come into a shell and be entirely defensive like Azhar Ali, even though credit to him for playing 173 deliveries on that track. You cannot get into that shell because the runs stop coming.
Speaking of Azhar Ali, he's going to be captain in the side and there's no Misbah. Before we move on to the last topic of the day, which is England versus India, let's just discuss Azhar Ali's captaincy. How do you think he's going to respond and how will he fill those giant-sized boots that Misbah has left?
Lina, you need to have an aggressive captain. I mean, mostly what we see, I've been following cricket since late 60s. I've seen Hanif Muhammad captaining, I've seen Saeed Ahmed, I've seen Majid Khan, I've seen Intikhab Alam, I've seen Asif Iqbal, I've seen blah, 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 so many. Well, I have never seen a good captain except Mushtaq Muhammad. He, in fact, taught Pakistan to win the test match. 1978, yes.
Oh, brilliant.
And 1976, Australia.
Yeah.
Well, and then, of course, Pakistan had got a long period with another captain who in fact won the matches for them. Otherwise,
yes.
I don't think there is any other person who has impressed me. I mean, most of the cricketers, they had been pretty ordinary as captains.
But how do you think Azhar Ali's
captaincy? And Azhar is one of them.
Yes, in one day he hasn't been able to impress. But two, in fairness, the one day side hasn't been that great also. But also, I am of the opinion that if you make a certain guy the captain, he then should be given a year or two to develop as a captain. Because this is a job where essentially you learn on the job.
Why don't you do this when they are playing first class cricket?
Well, that
yeah,
too,
they should
and
they
I would
should, they
slightly
should.
Disagree over there. I think that leaders are born, they're not made, but yes, you should be given a certain amount of time and shouldn't be judged over a short period of matches. Thing with Azhar Ali is, in his batting approach and everything else, he is literally Misbah 2.0. He's the seed that Misbah has sown for Pakistan cricket.
Yeah.
But Misbah knows how to make that defensive-minded fields work, how to exploit his leg spinners to get wickets. Azhar has never captained Pakistan in a test match before, so he will definitely feel the heat. And while Misbah has been criticized so much for his defensive captaincy, he did bring fruit to the nation in from that England series, because in wickets that didn't seem a lot, he did get that good result for Pakistan.
Absolutely.
And the games he lost on Old Trafford was a complete dead rubber.
Oh, we could have won that series 3-1, actually.
Actually,
it was so sad that
the Edgbaston test was
still a great result.
Yeah. So I think it's, like you said, massive shoes to fill, and he will be feeling the heat. But Pakistan have got to channel their energies into their adjustability. These days, they're called the most adaptable cricketing nation on the planet, because everywhere else you see visitors lose horribly. So let's not keep our hopes down yet.
Very interesting fact that you brought up, that you said that leaders are born. And I'm saying that leaders are, they need to be given a chance, they need to be given a few years, especially captains, that you can develop with experience. I'm not a big believer of black and white. I'm a great big believer of the gray area. And I think the gray area is in between. A born leader, I feel, also needs to be given time to develop into a leader who can deliver results.
And you agree to an extent, your argument is correct, because it's a spectrum, right?
Yeah.
And like Zaidi Saab pointed out, that you have to give them that experience on first class and domestic level. And why I believe that Sarfaraz should be Pakistan captain in all formats after Misbah retires is because he has that experience. He's led Pakistan to an under-19 World Cup, and he has that leadership experience. You can see it on his face.
Yeah, he led the Quetta Gladiators quite well also.
Lina, my worry is not Hamilton. I'm looking through Hamilton towards towards Queensland. Brisbane, the fastest wicket on earth. I was there in Brisbane in 1995, and what happened? Pakistan lost the test match in 2 days, and we didn't know what to do on next 3 days.
Absolutely.
I mean,
free time for you guys to explore the city.
Well, I don't know.
Well, I'm glad Zaidi Saab brought up the GABA, because like he said, it's England called Trent Bridge their GABA. So, and I think Wahab Riaz will be Pakistan's most crucial bowler.
Oh, yeah, in Australia, definitely. Also, I feel here in Hamilton, he will be a
So, I think when you talk about Melbourne, Pakistan's second test match is, I think, in Melbourne, and third one is at Sydney. Those are easier wickets. My worry is Brisbane and not Hamilton. Well, if you can't play on fast wickets, then what is your utility in the side?
Absolutely. But, you know, Zaidi Saab, I feel sad for the batsmen, because, you know, like you said yourself, they're not given enough opportunities to play on such wickets. And yet, I think they're good batsmen with a lot of courage, that within one or two test matches, they learn and win you test matches. In England also, the wickets weren't this fast, but they were good wickets. The ball was seaming. There was a bit of swing. The overcast conditions in England have a great big effect on the state of the game. So, I think the result in England was pretty good. And I think the result here might not be that bad also, because I feel if they had a three test match series, would have been great, but I feel they probably make a good comeback.
I would have loved to see Pakistan's Sialkot emerging as woolen GABA of Pakistan.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. That would have been great. So enough talk about Pakistan and New Zealand, and we could talk about it, like I said yesterday also, for ages and ages. Less time left in the show, so time to talk about England versus India in Mohali, which should be a different wicket than Vizag. Your take, Zaidi Saab.
Yes, of course, this time it will be a different wicket, and we are expecting England to perform better, because this wicket will be more friendly towards batsmen if the curator doesn't do something extraordinary.
Like Ravi Shastri said last time, I requested him and he changed the wicket. He said on air. Anyways, do you see Duckett should be out and Jos Buttler in?
Yes, I do. I think Duckett's had enough opportunities since the Bangladesh tour. And this is one of England's most important tours. And Jos Buttler does have some test match experience.
So it's a similar situation. Jos Buttler, a similar type of player like Shergill.
Thing is, Lina, that Johnny Bairstow hasn't performed that well behind the stumps. He's been exceptional with the bat, but his performance behind the stumps has been slightly ordinary. So I think Jos Buttler would fill in as a keeper nicely. And England, they need to attack to some extent as well.
But they should never, and I say never, and I say never, drop Bairstow. Never.
I think he's a fantastic find. In fact, that other day,
Pakistan should never drop Sarfaraz.
Yeah. Look at his performance in last 8-10 test matches.
Well, in this past year, 2016, 772 runs between Johnny Bairstow and Ben Stokes, the most by any batting pair in test cricket. That says a lot. Yeah. But what I think the key for England will be is to not be so defensive, do go for the ball, and they need to get lucky with the toss. My friend
talked about Ben Stokes, who is an all-rounder, and mind went towards Pakistan. Unfortunately, this is an era where we are not producing any all-rounders.
And we needed to, Zahir Saab, we had the opportunity of grooming someone like Anwar Ali, Bilawal or Hamad Azam. We didn't groom either of these gentlemen.
Unfortunately, I think Hamad has come back to Pakistan after his operation, but still not fit enough to play.
Well, he's a young man, he'll probably be fit in 6 months. But we need to realize that a fast bowling all-rounder is a must.
I think one of the best left-handed batsmen I ever saw. I've seen many greatest of the left-handers. But Hamad has got confidence and he has got the technique.
And that's what's hurting you right now, isn't it? I mean, this would be a perfect time to introduce an all-rounder into the squad because there was a slot open. But then again, fast bowling all-rounders, there's a drought in Pakistan. The only one I can think of right now is Amir Yameen, and he hasn't been given enough ample opportunities.
I mean, you know, there are germs in Bilawal Bhatti, there are germs in Anwar Ali, and definite germs in Hamad Azam. They could have, you know, and these chaps were spotted years ago. So if someone worked on them, for instance, you know, just assign someone to work on these three players and groom, at least after three, groom two as future all-rounders. I mean, then we could have gotten, I'm being, you know, going over the top when I say Jack Callis or, you know, Stokes or someone, or Ian Botham or Imran Khan. But, you know, we would have gotten someone.
Well, maybe they can groom Imad Wasim. He's shown the most seeds,
but
I would believe.
But
he's not a fast bowler. But then again,
I'm talking about a fast bowling.
I agree with that. And there are no Azhar Mahmoods or Razaks in the current crop of players. But we still need an all-rounder. We still need someone who can both bat and bowl. And the most, the best prospect to me looks like Imad Wasim, even though he's a spinner. But he's sort of like an English swinger.
I like him a lot. I like him. I interviewed him here and I talked to him in detail about everything, even of the about the fact that if he wants to play test matches, he needs to spin the ball. And he said, I'm working with Mushi Bhai on that. So he has that in mind. And he I feel, is a better option than Nawaz at the moment.
Lina, the scary picture is that Pakistan does not have to face, after three test matches, the Aussie way of handling the situation. I mean, six executors.
Well, that is a bit harsh,
they had a very, very bad year. I mean, you know, they probably shouldn't have gone so drastic, but then maybe this will work for them.
But anyhow, while we go through, we were talking about our domestic cricket. Ian Chappell is talking about some flaws in the domestic Sheffield Shield games, and he wants to improve it. And I think Stevie Smith has also mentioned about the domestic circuit of Sheffield Shield.
Next time we were short of time. Next time we meet, we will talk about the fact that how unfair the toss could be in all conditions and how we can make it to be a more fair thing for the tourists.
So you have not forgotten Hagley Oval.
No, I haven't forgotten anything. So we haven't got forgotten anything, and the toss, it gives unfair advantage to the home side, and I feel that in the coming months the ICC should also look at how they could make it a more neutral thing. Maybe the toss shouldn't have so much importance and the game should take precedence rather than the toss taking precedence over everything else, especially in the subcontinents, and also conditions like like in New Zealand where it's overcast and it's raining and then you lose a toss and you have to bat on a wicket which is, you know, balls are coming right on your face and seaming away. Anyway, it was just a brilliant discussion this evening. I really enjoyed it. We discussed some great things and enjoyed this show. I hope you enjoyed it at home also. I don't want to be tooting my own horn all the time, but it was a good show. I enjoyed it. I hope you did also. On that note, you take care. Till next time, bye-bye.